Morning, everyone. Happy Valentine's Day. It's good to see you out today, and all that you are watching online, and the few that are gathered here in the sanctuary. We're so glad to have them, have everyone with us. We want to welcome Matt Steep, who's leading our band today, and we welcome him. He's a junior over at Olivet at the Nazarene College. What are you studying, Matt?
Music ministry.
Music ministry, perfect, wonderful, welcome, Matt. Our Matt got hooked into this Matt, so we have Matt 1 and Matt 2, our double Matts. All right, friends, I just want to remind you, Ash Wednesday is this Wednesday. We will have services at 10 a.m. and 7 p.m., and so we'll have an opportunity for you to do a special time of repentance, and we'll take communion, and we'll also have an opportunity if you want to do the imposition of ashes. Now, I've had both of my vaccines, but I will be wearing a mask when I do the imposition of ashes, just for extra safety for you. And so I hope you can come, and you can participate in any of the service without having the imposition of ashes. That's not mandatory. So you can do that if you choose. But I hope that you'll join us and for this special time as we begin the journey of Lent. We're using the book The Walk by Adam Hamilton as our guide. We will have kids club that day in the afternoon as normal, but the youth groups, Ignite and Real, will be invited to come to worship. So that's our plan for Wednesday, and the next Sunday we'll begin our sermon series on the walk, and our first one is worship and prayer, which we've been talking about a lot, so that'll reiterate, and we will kindle some new things on how we worship. And so those are our announcements. You can look in the bulletin and in the announcements for others. We want to say happy birthday to people having birthdays. Sharon's birthday is tomorrow, and her husband, Bob Bossard, is going to be having knee replacement surgery. So we ought to be extra nice to Sharon this week as she deals with that. But happy birthday to everybody else having birthdays, and happy anniversary to Marvin and Sherry having their anniversary tomorrow, too. Friends, God is good.
All the time.
God is good.
Let's prepare our hearts for worship and stand and sing This Amazing Grace.
Drinks of power, oh sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above. This is amazing grace. Done for me. That you would be my you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace.
You may be seated. Let's pray together. Thank you, loving and gracious God, for helping us to have a place to gather and to worship your name. You are worthy of our adoration and praise this day. And as we think about commitments, we thank you for your great faithfulness to each of us. And as we live in that faithfulness this day, help us then to be faithful in the vows and promises we make to you and to others. Fill us with your Spirit as we worship you right now. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Well, it's time for our children's moment for all ages, so everyone will have to participate. So what, today we're talking about promises and covenants. So what is a promise or a covenant? What is it? How would you define it? Anybody? Children of all ages, that's you all.
A vow.
A vow? All right. Well, what does that mean? Is a vow A-E-I-O-U?
You do what you say.
Oh, you'll do what you say you'll do. Is that right? Would you all agree with that? That a contract means I'll do this and you do that. I mean, that's when we make contracts with businesses that we expect them to hold a warranty or that kind of thing. And a promise is that, right? And so are people good at keeping promises?
Sometimes
yes, sometimes no. Well, let's say your dad said, if you had a sporting event, your dad said, I'm going to be there. But there was an accident on Interstate 55 and he got stuck. He couldn't keep his promise. Uh-oh. Or let's say you promised that you were going to be good at school. Or like me, I promise I will stop talking so much. I'll listen. Not happening. That didn't work. But who can keep their promise? God. And so this represents God making his promises to us. And let me see if I can tear this. This is a Bible. I can't do it. Because God's promises are not broken. God keeps his promises. And as we live and experience God keeping his promises to us, then that empowers us to keep our promises to others. So that when we say, we'll do. That's a saying we have in our family, saying and doing. If you say it, better do it. Mostly we're talking about picking up clothes or putting away dishes at our house, but it goes a lot bigger than that, saying and doing. So let's promise together to keep promises, and let's share this Bible verse together. For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. And so through him, the Amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20. And the Amen says, so be it. So we're agreeing with God's promises. So God's promises, no matter what they are, how many he's made, they're always yes in Christ, means Christ fulfills them. And we as Christians then say, Amen, so be it. And that's also a way we keep our promises. When we say Amen, we mean so be it. Let's pray together. You can repeat after me. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, loving and gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for keeping your promises. Thank you for keeping your promises. Forgive us for breaking our promises. Forgive us for breaking our promises. Through your Spirit, help us to keep all the promises we make.
Help us to keep all the promises we make.
Especially our promise to love and serve you.
Especially our promise to love and serve you.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. And now we're going to have our time of making our promises as married couples. So if any of you who are married or in a covenant with each other would like to renew your covenant vows, this is your opportunity. And so... So if any of you, I don't know if you all would like to do that. So if you want to do it, you can go ahead and stand together. And then you face each other and you can take off your mask if you want. And remember, you're talking to each other. So are you waiting for her to get? Oh, there, that's fine. You can lean over each other. And I will help you lead this. But first, you can look at the screen and share this prayer together. Let's pray. On this day of recommitment and renewal, we give you, O Lord, thanks for your past blessings and for your continual mercies. We thank you for each passing day. You have increased and deepened our love for each other. We praise you for all the joys of our home and family life. Renew your blessings upon us now as we renew the vows of love and loyalty. And may your Holy Spirit strengthen us that we may remain steadfast in our covenant to you and to one another through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All right, husbands, you get to go first to your wife, and this is a renewal of your vows. Look at each other and repeat after me. In the name of God and with a grateful heart, God and with a grateful heart, I once again declare that I, and say your name, take you and say your wife's name, to be my wife. To have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, until we are parted by death. This is my solemn vow. And wives to husbands will do the same thing. In the name of God and with a grateful heart, I once again declare that I, your name, take you to be my husband, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish until we are parted by death. This is my solemn vow. And if you want, you may seal your covenant with a quick kiss. Oh, that's so sweet. All right, let's all pray together. Good job, everyone. Eternal God, creator and preserver of all life, author of salvation, giver of all grace, bless and sanctify with your Holy Spirit those who have reaffirmed their marriage covenant. Enable them to grow in love and peace with you and each other all their days, that they may reach out in concern and service to all the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our next, yes, good job, everyone. Congratulations. And our next worship song is Come As You Are. If you want to stand up to be warmer, you can. Or you can remain seated.
Come all the sadness, wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow.
Thank you. And Bruce has got a special number for us to share that goes with our vows times, the wedding song. Mm-hmm.
He's now to be among you at the calling of your heart. Rest assured, this troubadour is acting on his part. The union of your spirits here has caused him to remain forever to gathered in his name. There is love. There is love. Well, a man shall leave his mother and a woman leave her. Travel on to where the two shall be as one. As it was in the beginning, is now until the end. Woman draws her life from man and gives it back again. And there is love. There is love. Becoming man and wife, is it love that brings you here, or love that brings you life? For if loving is the answer, then who's the giving for? Do you believe in something that you've never seen before? There is love. There is love. Oh, the marriage of your spirit here has caused him to remain for whenever two or more of you are gathered in his name. There is love.
Amen. Thank you, Bruce. Our scripture lesson today is the Shema, which is a promise that the Israelites and the Jewish people say every day. They say this promise every day. And I really like how the New Living Translation translates it. I think it's a very true translation. A lot of times we say the Lord is one, and people talk about the Trinity versus one God and three. But really, I think this translation is what the Shema is really talking about. So let's share God's word together for us from Deuteronomy 6. Listen, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. And you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commandments that I am giving you today. Repeat them again and again to your children. Talk about them when you are at home, and when you are on the road, and when you are going to bed, and when you get up. Tie them to your hands and wear them on your foreheads as a reminder. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to our great God. Well, I like to tell jokes at weddings, and the reason I do is because I find at weddings people are very stressed, and so they're not breathing enough. And when you laugh, you take in a lot of air, and so it keeps people standing instead of passing out. And I've only had a couple people pass out in the wedding. And I realized I got to add more jokes to my sermons. So this married couple I've been married a long time, and they were blessed enough to die close together. And so we're up in heaven, and St. Peter's giving them a tour. First, he takes them to this beautiful mansion, and the man was very impressed. Wow, this is really nice. And he goes, but I just have a question, Peter. How much does all this cost? Peter said, cost? This is heaven. Everything is provided. The man said. They walked on. He went into the beautiful banquet room, and the food looked so fabulous. And he said to the man, this is all yours. You can have as much as you want. And the man said, wow. He goes, now, how much does this cost? Peter said with a sigh, it's all free. It's provided for you. The man said. They both loved to golf, and so he took him out to the golf course, and the greens were immaculate. And he said, well, this is heaven. You can go golfing any day you want because it's always great weather. And the man said, and Peter said, now, before you ask, this is free. It's provided for you. Well, the man put his hand on his hip, and he looked at his wife, and he said, it's free. It's all free for us to use anytime we want. Yes, she said. You and your confounded bran muffins. We could have been here 10 years ago. We all have bran muffin issues in our lives, don't we? Well, making covenants and keeping covenants is a great way that we bless others, but it's also a great way where we ourselves are blessed. We learn and grow when we are faithful. We learn and grow also from our mistakes and our unfaithfulness, of course. But we learn something very powerful when we can power through and remain faithful in the midst of all sorts of different challenges. There is value to having commitment in our lives. Whether we're talking about the commitments of a husband and a wife and a marriage partner, or we're especially today talking about our commitments to God. There is great power in being faithful. And one of the awesome things about our great God is that we know he is always faithful to us. But when we proclaim we do in many different situations, then we are professing our commitment to do. And that's why the Shema is so powerful. What the Shema says is, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. We take God as ours. And that's a powerful statement and a very wonderful profession of faith. Whenever I do marriage counseling or any type of talking to people, I always like to know about their romantic experiences. Yes, I love Hallmark. Yes, I'm a romance addict. Yes, I like it. But I like to hear all the funny stories. I like to hear about how people met and all the different things, because it tells you a lot about them as a person, and it tells you about the person that they love, and I enjoy hearing that. And I encourage any of you that are in a relationship with others today that share with them, not just today because it's Valentine's Day, but many times throughout the year, I hope you share why is that person important to you? And not only in a marriage covenant, but your friendships. If you have friends with people, you should let them know why that's important, why they're important to you, what they do that helps you. Like if they're always faithful in picking you up or inviting you to go somewhere, you should say that to them. Thanks for always doing that for me. Or, you know, I really appreciate that about you, that you do this. I have a friend, and we send cards to each other because we're not living very close. But she started doing that several years ago. She'd write nice things about why her and her husband were so glad for Paul and Mai's friendship in their lives. And that meant so much to me. And I realized I need to do that more. Now, my husband and I are more like telling jokes to each other about stuff and making funnies about that. That's what we're really like. Because this week I was working on my hair, and I had not finished. I was like early in the process of my hair. And he goes, well, he came into my bathroom, and he goes, that's really not the glam look we were always going for, is it? No, it isn't. When you got mask on your hair and it's all gooped up. Yeah, I'm in the bathroom. I'm supposed to be by myself. But anyway, so we like to tease about that. But he's good about remembering fun things in our lives. And that's what I appreciate about him, is that he reminds us of some of the fun things that we like to laugh about. And like I said earlier, saying and doing, that's the thing in our lives we like to tease each other about. Saying and doing, you know, that's a fun way. Because I found if you can laugh about things, it makes the medicine go down a little better. Instead of getting mad, you know, that the keys are lost again for the 500th time, or, you know, whatever's happened for the 500th time, that you can laugh about it, and that helps each other have a better day. And I've told this before, but one thing we always do is tell each other that we love each other before we part. That's the last thing we say to each other when we go to bed. It's the first, you know, we say that in the morning. We're so glad we're married to each other. And that's what we say when we part. We love you. We look forward to seeing you the next time, you know, whatever. But we try to encourage each other. And that's not just for married people. That's important to do with any relationships we have. All of us are in different relationships with people. And people need to be encouraged that way. And so it's important for us to share. It helps us remind ourselves why, how valuable these people are in our lives, and it helps them. So I encourage you to use your words for good. Now, today is Transfiguration Sunday, and this is the Sunday we celebrate that Jesus took his closest friends. Now, we know Jesus had 12 disciples, but, you know, being close friends with 12 people is a little too hard to do. It's really not going to happen. And Jesus modeled for us. He had three really close friends. Does anybody know who they are? Peter, James, and John. The twins, the sons of Zebedee and Peter were his closest friends. And so he took them with him to see experiences that not everyone else got to see. And then they would share it with others. But those were his closest friends. So he took his closest friends on up to a mountain for a time of prayer. And they didn't know what was going to happen, but Jesus was being faithful, and he went up on the mountain, and the Lord revealed that he said again to Peter, James, and John, out to everyone, "This is my beloved son, listen to him." And that's what, when we start with the Shema, "Hear, O Israel, listen." Listen doesn't mean just hear. Listen means apply, right? You know when kids are not listening to you. And it's not that they're not hearing you. They might be able to repeat exactly what you said. They're not doing what you say, right? And I'm pretty good at that because, like, in school, I'm a talker. And so I get in trouble for talking. And the teacher says, "You haven't heard anything I said." But I could repeat back everything they said. But I wasn't listening because the listening person was quiet. That was one of the things they said, be quiet. But I wasn't being quiet, right? How it's disrespectful. I wasn't showing respect to them by not listening. But hearing means applying it. And so they went up on the mountain, and while they were up there, Jesus was transfigured before them. He was changed into glory. And so this was an encouragement for him too, in his living out his faith here amongst us, to encourage him. And he was listening to Moses and to Elijah. Now, Moses and Elijah represent the law and the prophets. And so Transfiguration is a Sunday where we celebrate the completion, that Jesus is the completion of the law and the prophets. He's the fulfillment of that. And his faithfulness fulfilled that. But what I want to tell you is when you are being in covenant or you are keeping your commitments, you experience times of glory. And anyone who's married will tell you that's true, or in a relationship. When you are faithful to that person, you have times that make you feel better than any other time in your life, right? Anything you've ever experienced. And it's true. I have never been so happy in my entire life, and I've had a very happy life. I've been very blessed than when with my husband. I've been very happy. And sometimes the longer we're together, it's the oddest things that make me more happy. Like those little crazy comments. I mean, like when we were first married, we didn't go anywhere near the bathroom while the other person was in the bathroom. So it's funny to me now, too, that I just think that, well, we've come a long way, I guess. Not the way I'd want to, but that's what happens in married life. But that's what happens when you keep covenant. When you are faithful, you experience blessing. And that's so true. And this, I love this Abraham Lincoln statement. Commitment is what transforms a promise into reality. Because when we make these promises, Like when we promise to be faithful to God, but when we promise to be faithful to each other, we have expectations of joy, of happiness, that things are going to be awesome. But it's our commitment that transforms that promise into a real thing in our lives. And that's true in all sorts of areas of our lives. When we make a commitment and stick to it, then we see blessing that we wouldn't experience otherwise. And it's true not in just in loving relationships, but like work relationships too. We find we grow and we are blessed when we are faithful. And it's not easy. But when we keep our commitments, we have comfort in times of trial, but we also find strength to get through times of hardships. And we need to remind ourselves of that blessing. And the wonderful thing about our commitment with God is always faithful, right? When God made his promises, in here is a little rainbow, but that's the first evidence of God's promises that he gave the world. Do you know that? At Noah, when the flood was over, God put a rainbow in the sky. That's his first covenant. And it wasn't just with humanity, it was with the entire creation, promising that he would never flood the earth again. But whenever you see a rainbow, you should think of God's promises, that God keeps his promises, that God's keeping his promise, that God's remembering that he is faithful. But there's other ways that God showed he was faithful. When he made a promise to Abraham, he called Abraham when he was 75 years old. Now that is a lot. So just remind yourselves when you read the Bible that God doesn't care about age. He has no age discrimination. And so he called him when he was 75, but he didn't give him a child until 25 years later. He called Abraham and said, "Hey, I'm going to make you a great nation. In fact, your descendants, your children, your family are going to be so numerous, there are going to be more of them than there are grains of sand on a seashore." Now, if you've ever picked up just a handful of sand, you know there's a lot of grains of sand in the sand in your hand, let alone on the whole seashore and all the whole world's sand. That's a lot of sand. Now, if you had no children and you were 75 years old, wouldn't that make you think that that's kind of iffy on whether this promise is going to be kept? But Abraham believed him, and he counted his righteousness. But it didn't happen for 25 years. So God makes promises, but God might take time in answering those promises. So if you feel like God has made a promise to you and it hasn't happened yet, give it some more time. God takes time in doing things. He is faithful, but he takes time. But those kind of things when we see in the Bible are witness that God can do impossible things. He can make a man who's 99 and a woman who's 90 have a baby. That's pretty amazing. But he can do a lot more than that. You see, our God is able through his mighty power to work within us, to do all sorts of things, more than we can imagine. So you can't ever ask God too big of a question. You can't ever ask God too big of a thing to do for you, because God is able through his mighty power to do more, even more than we can think or imagine. We might think, well, I'm asking a lot. And I've had times like that in a life of a church where I thought, man, this is a lot. I've had a lot of prayer requests for people's health and things. I thought, man, this is so much. But I know God is able through his mighty power. You can't over ask God to do things. And if it's according to his will, he will do. So we can't think of how much God is able to do. Our minds aren't big enough to catch that. God is faithful and does even when we're not faithful. God doesn't wait on us to answer our prayers. So I don't believe that if people say, well, this prayer hasn't been answered because you're not faithful. No, it's not God's time yet, or it's not the way God determined it. Because God's faithfulness is not determined on my faithfulness. Jesus proves that over and over again. But God does teach us on what to do when we're not faithful. And that's forgive. And I don't know about you, but that's probably one of the hardest things for me to do in keeping. But when I'm in a covenant, I know I'm going to break it. I'm going to rip my promises. People are going to rip their promises to me. And so I'm going to need to learn how to forgive. I'm going to learn how to forgive myself, and I'm going to have to forgive other people. That's part of being in the world. And God forgives us in Christ. And thank goodness, the best way to restore relationships when covenants are broken is through forgiveness. And that's why Jesus came. Because we couldn't keep our covenant with God. We've never been able to keep our covenants with God, but God made this covenant through Jesus. So he's not determined on us. So if God didn't forgive us, we wouldn't be able to be in a relationship with him. But God loves us. And so he forgives us in the name of love, which is Jesus. And so our invitation is to forgive other people. And like I said, it's hard for me. As I told First Service, I like to carry those things around when people have hurt me, and I like to grind my teeth on them. It's not good for me, but, you know, it's how I live, and it's a sin. I try to keep doing it, and I've told them, I like to even, sometimes, have you ever had somebody stress you so much that you have nightmares about them? Yes, it's terrible. So when that happens to me and I wake up in the morning, I pray for me to be me and a nightmare for that person. That's not Christian. Don't do it. But instead, I should forgive them. If I would forgive them, because who's all this hurting? Who's all this stressing? Who's having the bad dreams? Me, not them. They probably aren't even thinking about it. I've had times where someone has hurt my feelings or something, and honestly, they did not have any clue that even happened. That was not their intention. Now, I've had people do stuff that they intended to do, of course, and that's harder to forgive. But I've had people that didn't even know, and yet I'm carrying it around, stressing about it, and I need to let go of it. So we're going to talk more about forgiveness through Lynn. But the power of Christ is that through his body and blood for us, he became our sin and took away our sin so that we could be right with God. He's the fulfillment of these promises and covenants with him. And so every time we take communion like we did last Sunday and like we're going to do again on Wednesday, we're claiming that truth. We're claiming that forgiveness. We're claiming that Christ is the fulfillment of all promises, that it's not up to us, but that through Christ we can be faithful, that we can power through tough times and not give up on our promises, that we can do things that people think are amazing. Like we might say we're going to do something and we've never done it. And they're like, you're never going to do it. You're never going to do it. And we do it. And they're shocked, but it's because Christ is living in us and we've lived the promise. And so every time we take communion, we take the body and blood of Christ, that empowers us to be better at keeping our promises. And of course, the Holy Spirit helps us to do this. In Jeremiah 31, it tells about the new covenant that is coming in Christ. And the new covenant is when we will all know God, when people won't have to teach us about Christ and remind us about our faith anymore, because we will know it. We'll keep the Shema. We'll talk about God's laws and God's ways all the time. So we won't have to just come to church to do it. We'll be doing it all the time. And the whole world will be filled with faith. And that's a powerful covenant. That's a powerful covenant that fulfills all the other covenants ever made. The new covenant, the complete covenant. And when we do that, then we can approach God's throne with confidence because Christ is living in us. And we know that it's not based even on our own faithfulness, which can break at any time, but on God's faithfulness, which doesn't break. It's the mystery of the gospel and how we can know God and know his love. But that's how big his love is for us. That's how great his love is for each of us and how powerful our God is. So today I invite you to make a covenant with Christ, to say this promise. We're going to listen to God and we're going to say, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. And we're going to love God with all that we have and all that we are. And in that love, we're going to be transformed. That we're going to say yes to Christ and all the invitations he invites us to do. Even if it's forgiving someone that's hard to forgive. Maybe it's being patient with someone that we have no patience with. Maybe it's being strong in ways we don't have the strength for. Maybe it's doing the right thing when everybody else is doing the wrong thing. We're going to say yes and keep our new covenant. We're going to be able to love abundantly, and not just the people who are lovable, but the people that are very challenging to love. We're going to be able to live boldly when we live in Christ's covenant. We're going to live into the fullness of God. That's God's will for each of us, friends. As long as we accept the invitation and we say yes, we say the amen, we say we do. The Lord is our God, the Lord alone. That's who we are. And when we say that and live that, then we find blessing upon blessing in this world as we're preparing for the world to come. We find out in this world how big our God is and how deep his love is for each of us. When we learn how Christ is faithful to us, then we can be faithful in Christ. And that's what God wants for each of us. Amen. Amen. Our Wesley covenant is what we're going to do next, and this is in the Wesleyan tradition. And I just want to point out a couple parts to it to you that, you know, make me what you will, let me be about what you'll do, put me aside if you won't. As you're saying those things, those are the hardest things for me. You know, sure, I like to be used for uplifting things, but to be think about being put aside for Christ, ooh, that's harder. And sometimes we see people are. I mean, you see that sometimes you need to step back and let God do things in other people and encourage them. And that is hard to do. So let's share the Wesley covenant together. Let's pray. Oh Lord, help us to fully commit our lives to you. Remind us that we are no longer our own, but yours. Put us to what you will. Rank us with whom you will. Put us to doing, put us to suffering. Let us be employed by you or laid aside by you, exalted for you or brought low for you. Let us be full, let us be empty. Let us have all things, let us have nothing. We freely and completely yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are ours and we are yours. So be it. And may the covenant which we have made on earth be ratified in heaven. Amen. Amen. As we come to our time of prayer, we have some joys to lift up. Folks are doing a little better. They still need our prayers for healing, but Janice Madsen's doing well with her therapy, but she continues to need prayers for healing. DeHanna, of course, continues to need our prayers. Rosie Miller, John Geshwin, he's doing pretty well too, doing better. But Alita Leach continues to need our prayers for healing. She should be up here singing, and she's not Amen. Here with us, and we need to pray for her healing. Kaylin, Matt's wife in the sound booth, is, you know, 7 months pregnant now, so she's made another month. So, yeah, we're going to keep praying that baby's going to stay in there. Of course, Vicky's back with us at church today. Praise God for that. So she's doing good with her healing. We want to continue to pray for Tammy Pulver and Christine, Rodney Carlson's daughter, Christine, who's battling terrible cancer, and all our people on our cancer list. Please pray for their healing. Dave Siebert's continuing to make slow progress, but progress. But especially today, I want you to pray for Bob Bossert. As I said in the announcements, he is having knee replacement surgery tomorrow, and tomorrow is Sharon's birthday, his wife. So please pray for them and pray that they have a good day today. He's in isolation, he told me. He had to take his COVID test. And then he's in isolation today, or been in isolation since he took his test, so he'll be able to go have his surgery tomorrow. So we're thankful that the weather's, and even though it's terribly cold, it's, you know, not snowing right now, and so tomorrow should be okay for them to make that trip to get that surgery. So we'll be praying for that. Let's pray together. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, as we quiet our hearts before you, we are so thankful for your great mercy. We're thankful that this morning, each morning, your mercies are new because great is your faithfulness. As you examine our hearts, O Lord, we do ask that you forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, especially for the many ways we break our promises to you and to others. O Lord, help us today to make recommitments and to be more faithful in the relationships that we have in this life and our relationship with you. As we enter the season of Lent on Wednesday, we do ask that you show us the things that we might need to give up or the things that we might need to take up. This has been such a hard year for us with the COVID pandemic. We've lost so much. So show us things that we might need to take up, like joy, like love, like encouragement. bring to mind people who today, especially on Valentine's Day, that this might be a hard day for, that our voice might be an encouragement to. And help us make that call or send that text or email, that note, to just let them know we're thinking about them and what they bring into our lives that's a blessing. Oh, Lord, thank you for the many ways you love us and heal us. And we do thank you for the physical healings that so many have seen. We especially lift up Bob to you right now, that you're preparing him for his surgery tomorrow, and you're preparing the surgeons and all who will be caring for him, that you'll protect him from infection and let this be a good act of healing for him. We thank you that Vicky is doing so well, and we pray Bob may have that same good outcome. But we also pray for Janice and Dee, for Rosie and Lita, for John and Dave, that your healing be upon each of them and that you continue to knit them back together and strengthen them. We pray, oh Lord, especially for Kaylin, that you just continue to help her and the baby thrive, and that you provide help for the pain that she continues to have with these headaches, that you provide for that. But we thank you that the baby is continuing to grow, and we just ask that she has a safe delivery, but that it happens in a couple months from now so that the baby can be as strong as possible. Lord, thank you for giving us good health care, but we especially pray for deliverance from people battling cancer. And we just ask that your healing will rest upon them this day. Lord, thank you that your mighty power is able to do more than we think or imagine. And so we give these and our unspoken concerns to you in confidence. Let us be ever faithful, imitating your faithfulness, Lord. But even more, let us be forgiving to ourselves and to others when we fail, just as you are always forgiving to us, again, showing your faithfulness. Today, let us be instruments of love and peace as we go about in our worlds, in our daily lives, and in whatever activities we're about, because you go with us. We thank you for your special gift of the Holy Spirit, and especially for your Son, Jesus, who loved us and lived for us and died and rose to victory for us. In his precious name always we come. And we continue praying together the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I love it when I forget how the Lord's Prayer ends. It's quite amazing. Let's stand together and sing our closing praise forever.
Forever.
friends, receive the benediction. Go forth witnessing to love in this world so that to whom love is a stranger might find in you a generous friend. May the grace of Christ attend you, the love of God surround you, and the Holy Spirit keep you so that you may grow in holy love, find delight in all that this life offers, and remain faithful to Christ until your life ends. Amen. 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 Let's sing our closing praise, You Are My King.